Hey friends, I'm so glad that you're joining me today. And first and foremost, welcome you to the Stars of Learning show. And I'm your host, Jyoti Ji. And you know that, right? Each fortnight, I interview the thought leaders in the learning industry who will share their best practice, challenges, solutions, latest trends, and their journey, you know, which will fast track you to engage, enlighten, and empower. So friends, do you agree that time is changing and that's forever, right? However, you might have seen even family dynamics is changing. Society is changing, mindsets are changing, including relationships, right? And most importantly, parenthood is changing. More than that, I would like to call parenthood is evolving. And that's what I learned from my special guest I have today on my show. Well, it's not a cakewalk to be a parent and have the perfect balance, right? And I believe and I know that because I am myself being a parent, parenthood is a beautiful place to be. And I'm still enjoying the moments. These titles like mother and father not only give us a big opportunity to, you know, teach and bring up our child in a valuable, you know, successful way, but we also in the process teach very good life lessons at the same times. And in the process, we also get to revise and experience them all over again from a different and a fresher perspective, right? When you interact with a child, you experience all that. So friends, today in this episode, we are going to talk about reinventing parenting journey with our one and only guest, Kavita Yadav, who is the founder of Gina Living Positively, who is working in the field of training, counseling, and psychology for more than 17 years. She is the author of a book, Parenting, and she is a qualified and certified parenting coach and expert working passionately in the field of mental health, mental well-being, parenting, relationship, career, counseling, emotional well-being, and many, many other fields, friends. So what's interesting is Gina's vision. You know, they want to stand to transform 100 families every year by empowering people and create community of effective, conscious, happy parents and children. And they do this with the help of a scientific-based research work and many other elements they bring in when they do this kind of a counseling and training and, you know, coaching for the parent and the child. And friends, I and Kavita are from the same L&D community, and her blogs on relationship, parenting, work life are mind-blowing. And I have benefited, especially the one of the teenagers' blog, what Kavita has written. And since I have the teenage kid, I was able to connect. I was able to apply what I learned in that blogs or what I go through her videos, which are very powerful. I think those are powerful, practical parenting tips which she gives. Very simple to apply, friends. And I feel that is something every house, every family, every organization, or, you know, every individual need to be aware, because the future is our children, right? And to have that kind of a progressive world, we need to be aware, we need to be conscious, we need to be happy in upbringing the child and support parenthood in a right way. So friends, stick till the end, as parenting journey is where you need to keep sharpening your skills to keep pace with your child and to build that bond stronger for a happy and conscious parenting. And that's what I learned from my very special guest I have today. And you will definitely get loads of insight, which will be shared by Kavita. So wear your gears on and join me to welcome my guest, Kavita Yadav. Hey, Kavita, once again, a warm welcome to Stars of Learning podcast. And lovely to see you on my show.
Hi, thank you, Jyoti, and thank you so much. And thank you for having me on your show. So looking forward to have this interaction with you.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, Savita. Kavita, again, this topic is something very close to my heart, and I thought my listeners would benefit. And you are a certified expert, right? I see that great testimonials coming on your websites too from so many parents, and I'm thrilled to know more. So let's get started. My first question to you is, you know, like, parenting itself is a subject itself is like an ocean, right? And parenting is a two-way journey. And we need to focus on what we learn from our kids as well as what we teach to our children. And I believe it is a very sacred responsibility. So to begin, Kavita, I always follow Simon Sinek principle of why. So give us your insights on why parenting is important.
Okay, Jyoti. So your question itself has the answer. It is a journey and that two way, as you mentioned rightly. So, and for making this journey a happy, healthy and safe one, child needs the guidance, protection, love and warmth. Mm. So let me ask you at this point, do you like gardening?
Yes.
Have you ever sown a seed or a sapling?
Yes, I just did yesterday, bringing a tulsi plant in my garden.
Okay, wow. And what after that? Does it grow on its own?
No.
So it also needs the care and nurturance, you would agree with me, of a gardener out there, right? So there are some plants which do grow on their own also. But right, what about the quality of that plant, right? And what about the quality of one which is taken care of and shifted to shade and sunlight as required time to time, is watered, is manured properly, is also pruned from time to time. So there's a difference between the quality of these two plants out there. So similar thing is into parenting, right? So it's not only that by giving birth, you become a parent. Yes, you officially become one, but to be truly a deserving, you need to take proper care of the child's primary needs initially. And continuing on this journey, I would say, you also need to take care of the child's emotional, mental, and spiritual health out there. And while you're parenting, you're raising a child from birth to an independent, responsible adult. So with parenting, you're shouldering a huge responsibility of raising another human being. And help the person, the child, transit from one development stage to another, right? Successfully. Right. In all aspects, I would say, physically, emotionally, and mentally.
True. Very aptly put. I love the context of gardening, how you brought in Kavita. People can relate so very well. And I also feel that, you know, sometimes we never know the love of a parent till we become parent ourselves, right? Aptly said, Kavita. And I also feel it's time to revisit parenting thoughts. And we need to infuse positive parenting. And I see that lot in your blogs and all that. So are there any guidelines or principles, because you coached so many parents, to be a good parent? And how do we know that, you know, we are competent as parents?
Okay. So, well, who are good parents? And what are the characteristics of a good parent? Parents who wish their children to grow up into independent, responsible adults with qualities like self-control, kindness, cooperation, compassion, and are able to do that by being present in the life of their children, by being a role model to their children, loving and accepting unconditionally, and by having open, honest communication with their children. So in my view, if you ask me, there's no such thing as a good or a bad parent. What may seem bad to you, maybe that is what is required for the child at that moment. As we discussed just before this, that parenting is a journey. As a parent, you ought to be willing to unlearn and relearn to match up with the present times so that you remain competent as parents.
Okay. Somewhere, you know, that independence, parents have started to feel that, you know, that their remote control has gone into the hands of their children. And they're now feeling that burn, Kavita. So you as an author of the book, right, Parenting, and you call out three C's in parenting. And that has been a great takeaway for me too, you know, that three C's really stand out. It's just not in parenting. I think in every conversation, we can keep that live. So please give a gist to my listeners on why those three C's are important.
Okay, so the three C's that I talk about in my book are communication, collaboration, and celebration, Jyoti. Yeah. And why these three C's are important? Well, the journey will become boring if you're not communicating with your co-travelers. And on this journey as parents, your co-travelers are your children. True. So not only to help them develop their speaking skills and enrich their vocabulary, but also to help them understand that expressing themselves, their thoughts, their emotions, their feeling is so important. True. So you need to have this first C, communication, well in place. And now coming to the second C that I mentioned in my book is called collaboration, right? So with your co-travelers, you need to collaborate. And on this journey, when you collaborate with your children, it does not become a burden, right? You rather make it more fun and filled with new learnings. And your children are observing you and they're absorbing all that they're observing. Okay. So, and the last C that I talk about in my book is called celebration. So once you collaborate with your children and you communicate with them, you need not wait for the final result or the outcome to applaud them. Rather, that is not the point at all. So the point is to celebrate the efforts made by children on this journey while they're developing from one stage to another. Because children and we as parents, both are work in progress. So let's applaud them and celebrate their little efforts that they do. And as you rightly mentioned, these three C's are just not limited to parenting, right? You can take them to another areas of your life, another relationships in your life out there, and see how beautifully they're fitting. So be it your workplace or in your personal space.
Sure. You have relate that. Looking at your blogs, your videos, your posts, and see that passion on parenting and their development, Kavita. And that's exactly has inspired me. And parenting is a journey where we spoke about that, you know, we need to keep sharpening our skills to keep pace with the children also, right? Like three C's, there are nonverbal cues also which child picks up from parents instantly. And also there are different stages in children's life. And as a parent, because I have a teen child and an adult child. So, and we need to pay attention at each stages and our moves are different for each child. And how do we be cautious in every move? What's your message to my listeners?
Absolutely, Jyoti. So, as the first C in my book stands for communication, it includes both verbal and non-verbal communication out there. You not always communicate just with words, right? You do that with your gestures, with your facial expressions, your body language, and all of that matters. So what you say surely carries weightage, but more than that, how you say adds more value, meaning, and importance to the context out there. And moreover, a child develops through various stages. And each stage has its own importance and fragility, I would say. Okay. So as parents or adults around the child, one needs to keep in mind the age of the child while communicating and also what is natural at that age for the child. So I would just share an example and help the audience understand out here is that I've seen parents describing their young children aged between 2 to 6 years as being stubborn, not sharing their stuff like toys with others, being selfish, self-centered. And even others around these children, if I can use the Hindi words, they would label them as like ziddi and matlabi ho gaya bahut zyada. Right? Kisi ke saath share hi nahi karta kuch bhi apni jo cheeze hain. So, but what one needs to know and understand is that given this particular age bracket, it is natural for children to behave like this. So there's a psychological term used here for children at this stage, and it is called egocentric. So a child is still learning to share what belongs to him or her. So for the child, it is not easy, and it is very natural to show that possessiveness for stuff and for people also, which he thinks belong to him. So it's not easy for the child to share, right? And while speaking to you, I don't know, Jyoti, whether the time permits or not, I recall a joke right now, if you allow me to share that joke with your audience. So look, it so happened that there was a PTM, like parents-teacher meet, and one grandmother went to the PTM of her grandchild. Okay. And as she was sitting in front of the teacher, so the teacher started complaining that, look, the child is so naughty and he does not sit at one place at all. He's very active and he keeps on moving all the time. And one after the other, the teacher was going on. And the grandmother was quietly listening to what the teacher had to say. So once the teacher finished, the grandmother replied or asked the teacher that, ma'am, if he will not do all this at this age, who will do? You or me? Because the grandchild was just a two-year-old child out there.
Okay.
So that is what we need to understand, that there are certain natural characteristics of each stage and each age which children will do and follow.
So how many stages are there like this, Kavita?
So look, the different stages, and different psychologists have come up with different stages, Jyoti, like, right? So it starts from birth and it goes till adulthood, I would say. Like Eric Erickson is one of the psychologists who has given different stages out there. Then Sean Piaget is another psychologist who has talked about these developmental stages. So different psychologists have categorized them according to their own this thing. But yes, a child transits from one stage to another and moves into adulthood.
And that's so important, right? That as a parents, we are the first teacher for the child, and we need to be aware of all these things. And child, as you mentioned, starts to learn language by observing too. And now we know the tips of effective parenting, and as a parent, we have to be conscious of how we upbring. And sometimes we derail, right? As a parent, you can't hold a guard all the time. And we happen to show our emotions and might have both beneficial and harmful effect, right? So so what's your take? Like, we see these in dramas, right? In the movies, or, you know, how looking at the circumstances, child picks up very fast and it can go in the right path or a wrong path. I'm sure it's happening in all our lives around. So what's your recommendation as a coach?
Emotions, right? A highly pertinent question with respect to parenting, Jyoti. And in these situations, a parent has to play the role of an emotional coach, where emotions come into picture, right? So it is a great opportunity for parents to showcase to their children as how to process emotions, accept them first, and express without hiding or completely unleashing them without limits. So I would say it is a very thin line to walk on. One has to be very, very cautious while doing it. Where I would say parents should not hide emotions, rather openly talk about them.
Okay.
And especially by taking ownership of them and showing the child how they're trying to deal with them. Okay. And these are also the opportunities for children to learn how to solve problems. With an example, if I have to like make the listeners understand, I would say that supposing you're feeling very sad and upset and you want to cry, right? I mean, you are so overwhelmed with that emotion of sadness within you right now. So you tell your child that you're very tired. You've had a bad day. That it's got nothing to do with the child, because what happens, the children understand or relate that we must have done something, therefore our parents are like feeling in a certain way most of the time if they're around. So we have to make it very clear that, bacha, it is nothing to do with you. And further, you may explain that you're going to sit down You'll relax for some time, or you need some alone time. And maybe in the meanwhile, you may be talking to your friend or a close family member also over the phone. And that is how you will feel better. So you need to let your child know about this, that there's a process, how to process the emotions when we are feeling too overwhelmed with them. So if next time you feel sad, angry, or frustrated, and your child is watching you, expressing those emotions, so do explain what's going on in terms that they can understand. Look, you need to keep the age of the child in mind while you're talking to them or expressing these emotions in front of them. So it could also be good for you, because children are wonderfully compassionate, Jyoti. And you would agree with me at this point of time. And you will often see that they offer so good and sane advice to us adults that brings a smile on our face instantly. That's what I would like to share about being an emotional coach to your children.
Sure. I think a very interesting perspective, Kavita, because, you know, parents really shoo away the child and keep them in silos. They don't know what is happening, you know, and you brought in a very valid point of openly talking and giving them that kind of a ownership and transparency. And that's how we can build a relationship, right? And in this kind of a journey, Kavita, I've also been connecting with so many employees and parents and all that. Sometimes I feel that not all parents are aware about this conscious process. And aim of parenting would be to nurture the child in all rounds, right? And that's what we want, you know. The conscious process is something is missing. So what would be your guidance to parents? Because, you know, sometimes I see my mom still worries about me while I have a grown-up child. And I know parenting is for a lifelong. So how do we make this parenting impactful and less stressful even to the parent, you know? So another thing which is bothering me is, should we stop over parenting? What's your thought on this?
Okay, so first clear statement that comes to me is that once a parent, always a parent.
Okay.
And till we are blessed to have our parents in our life, we will always be a child to them, isn't it? And that's so beautiful and such a blessing out there.
True.
So answering the next part of your question, Jyoti, about over-parenting. So what we need to understand here is that it is not what the child needs. It is actually a need of the parent, right? No way is it helping the child to learn, develop skills required to transit smoothly from one stage to another. But as parents, we do not want any extra chores to be added to our list. So we over-parent, right? You must have seen like mothers feeding their children just because they do not have the time and patience to wait for the child to finish eating on his own. Or maybe they're afraid of the mess that the child, young child will make while eating all by himself. So by over-parenting, the control remains, the remote control, I would say rather, of the child remains in the hands of the parents. And that is what is satisfying to the parents out there. So now it's a very conscious choice again that parents need to make about over-parent.
And what's that, you know, the conscious choice itself is so difficult, Kavita. So what's the process there as for a parent to be conscious?
So to be conscious, the first question that every parent needs to ask while we are around our children and while we are trying to give them some new life skill is that, in the way that I'm doing right now, the way I am around my child, is it really helping the child learn that new skill? Or is it just my satisfaction as a parent that I've done my job, I put a tick across this, and I'm done and dusted. So that is where the consciousness would come in. If you really want the child to pick up that new skill, you will have to have that patience. You will have to be present in the life of your children, be around them and allow them to make those mistakes from which they learn. Then only it would be a successful collaboration, I would say, as the second C in my book that I mentioned. So it has to be a handshake between a parent and a child.
Okay. Connecting to your previous insights, Kavita, on co-parenting, sometimes that, you know, most common among parents is that we push our dreams also on children. And and we wish, you know, we push it because we have seen that as a lack for ourselves, and we want our child to be a better version. And that's a good factor. However, how do we reduce, you know, such conflicts and be a best friends in the whole process with the children?
Okay. So that question brings so many memories to me. That in my initial period of parenting, I too am guilty of doing it. Yes. And it comes naturally. Because more than that, it is so because the way we were parented, what we learned and just simply absorbed and kept it with us without any filters out there. So I would say like in my case, I did MBA because my father always said that though he was able to crack IIM Ahmedabad in his times, but he did not go because there was no one to guide him. Okay. So when I cleared my MBA entrance, Jyoti, he was very happy. And I grew up with all the management books around me because my father was a banker. So in a way, I fulfilled his unfulfilled dream. Right? Now, I'm not saying that I have any regret of going that path for my career. I did enjoy and thoroughly enjoyed my stint into my corporate, this thing as an L&D expert and as an HR professional out there. However, when I unconsciously, I also did that with my daughter. It is then that I realized that children do feel the pressure. Like when I was young, I was learning guitar. Right. I started to learn guitar, but could not complete my training because the teacher left and went somewhere else. After that, no one really bothered that she was learning guitar and she has a break in between. And I couldn't continue with that learning. Okay. So when my elder one got a chance in her school to take an instrument to learn as a part of her music classes, I kind of pushed her to choose guitar. She also learned it for 2 years. Other than her school training, she went to a musical institute. I used to take her and bring her back. And for 2 years, she continuously was learning guitar. But after that, she never showed an interest. And that guitar is still there in my house like a showpiece, right? And yeah, and when I ask her the reason, she says that, Ma, she has no interest in music or any musical instrument to say. And I did it because it was mandatory in school. It was a part of a school curriculum.
Okay. Right?
So you see how it goes because we just carry it with us the way we were like being brought up. But to remove such conflict, you need not be the best friend of your child, Jyoti.
Okay.
Your friend already has a lot of friends. You may be the friendly parent and you rather be the friendly parent with your child. But do not be the friend.
Okay.
You understand the difference between just being a friend and being a friendly parent to your child. So there's a difference that comes.
Right.
So what I mean by that is that be the parent and nurturer around with your experience. And at the same time, be like a friend and have those honest, open communications with your children. And if need be, go and meet an expert who can guide you in the right direction. So break the myth around seeing experts and meeting people who can help you if required.
Interesting one. And I'm able to connect the dots and I can only say that, you know, the greatest gift a parent can give a child is a self-confident. And my dad always would say education is the best gift what we can give to our child. And I was able to connect that with your story also, you doing that education and all that. So and I like the part of, you know, you really called out very clearly saying that friendly parent, being a friendly parent and the being a friend. That's very important to draw that line as a parent. We need to be really cautious about that. So, Kavita, I see you be doing a lot of session to corporates, and it's high time that even organization leaders or HR or L&D, you know, has a lot of role to play in employee engagements, because, you know, they have a lot of, they hire a lot of people, right? And most of the people are parents, and working parents also have greater challenges. Right. Of course, HR do some programs on special days, on Parents Day or a Father's Day or a Mother's Day, and you know that Children's Day, and that bonding does happen. But then, as an expert, as a specialist, Kavita, what are your views to the organization? What kind of a role organization need to engage with employees to be a better parent? Because working parent has a, I feel that they have more challenge because they're not with them all the time.
Yes, Jyoti, a very valid question, I would say. So though a lot is changing around parenting nowadays, right? From the way it was looked upon as just a mother's job to take care of children. Now we see a lot of fathers taking keen interest and actively participating in bringing up children.
Oh yes.
So it's like from
that diversity is also there now.
Yes. So from changing nappies of newborns to helping them in their studies and projects, and bonding with their teens by playing with them and discussing about their friends, or simply cracking those silly jokes, but spending time with their children. So a lot has changed. And this connect and bonding is so much important for a child to develop beautifully and holistically. I know you would agree with me because you also are a mother and you can relate that thing, that how important it is to spend quality time with our children out there.
Yeah.
And now coming to corporates, your second question. So you would also agree that aliens don't work in the organizations. They're also humans, right? And most of them are parents. So people who work,
and they are not machines, they are human beings.
Yes, right. They are very much human beings, and they do have real-time challenges. So, the employees working there are human beings, as we saw. And so they have real-time challenges, Jyoti. They also have concerns related to their children. And corporates, they do a wonderful job when it comes to training their employees, right, on skill development required.
Right.
Performing a particular job in the best possible manner out there. But only remember them as parents on those special occasions, as mentioned by you, and that too only a 1 or 2 hour session at the maximum. So but my question is parenting a one day affair, or is it a few hours affair? Is it something it's that is standalone? It's lifelong, it's a journey. We have been discussing this since the beginning of our this talk, right? And it is something which is not standalone.
True.
And it does impact your professional life also.
Yes.
And your capability as an individual, right?
True.
So if I'm a happy parent, if I'm a happy father or a happy mother out there, the same will reflect in my work area also, in my performance, in my job, right? So when you become a parent, you get a second chance to be a better version of yourself. Parenting does not mean only the relationship between a parent and a child. It is an umbrella. It is a hub-like, right? And it encompasses so many aspects of an individual's life, relationships, emotional and mental health. So it would be great help and service if corporates make such sessions a regular feature of their training calendar for their employees out there.
And also, Kavita, this is something very crucial, especially on the mental well-being. I I've been talking to a couple of doctors and I hear this, okay? And that's how this question is coming to my mind. Like my parents and grandparents, right? They did not have any parental program, or they would laugh at it. Like, you know, if we had talked at that time, you know, because you talked about that umbrella, right? They had that kind of a support system, which was well knit at that time. And now this generation, it is the need of the hour with, you know, with secular family and both parents working. And I don't think parents even have really time to talk to the child every day. Okay. Mm. And do they greet them morning and night? I really doubt. Sometimes the child would have been fast asleep by the time the parent returns home. So that's been the mechanical life. And another burst is that people wonder about parent and child having a counselor also. There are a lot of myths around counseling, seeking help. Hey, how can I take an advice, guidance from a psychologist or even for a better parenting? So you are a certified expert in this. What is your advice in creating that healthy parenting life and knocking this bust around on, you know, having a good parenting?
So that reminds me of a real time example. I mean, a case, Jyoti, out there. So there was a child. So this child was like 8 to 9 years old. Mm-hmm. And he often used to complain. Right. They were advised to see a counselor or a psychologist. So once they met the psychologist, the finding was that parents used to fight regularly. They were not on good terms with each other. And child could not take all of this shouting, yelling, and fighting between the parents. So once he started crying, and on asking, he complained that I have a stomachache. And the parents immediately stopped their tussle and paid all the attention to this child. Now this child repeated this next time when parents were fighting. And the same result. So, you know, so that got patterned into the child that he has kind of got the golden key of locking the fights of his parents. So whenever they argue, the child complains of stomachache. So Jyoti, let me ask you that what is it that you get from this story? I mean, like this real case. It's not a story. It's a real case.
I feel the child has at least got that golden key. I'm happy for that.
Yes, that's a good thing that he got the golden key, but is it healthy? Is it healthy parenting?
No.
Right. So healthy parenting means like to be ready to work on your own self first.
Right.
So I always ask this question that who needs to unlearn what is not healthy and relearn the new age parenting mantras. As you were telling me that your grandparents and parents, and for that matter, even mine, they never had these parenting programs or books around them. Because those were the times when there used to be a joint family and so much of support system around. That was not required. That was not the need of the hour at that time.
Yes.
But times have changed since our parents were children to when they became parents. And we came into their life as children. And now we are parents. And we have our children.
True. Interesting.
So when we look around and open our eyes, the only constant, right? So the only constant thing is the change that is taking place.
Yeah.
However, the question still remains that who needs to change first, the child or the parent? Who needs to unlearn and relearn? The child or the parents? Who needs to work on their own self-limiting beliefs and patterns, the child or the parents? The listeners are listening, and if they answer these questions, they will have the answer.
True, true. This is like showing the mirror to the people, Kavita. Interesting one. So
it friends. Becomes important at times. It becomes important at times to do that.
True. So friends, the choice is yours with you. How you take, who needs to do all of these. You need to be aware, cautious, and in acceptance of it. And, you know, and bring that unconditional bias in the process of parenting, and definitely hearing to the case study what Kavita brought in, it really saves a tons of trauma what the child will go through, you know, with such kind of a parenting. Very important one, Kavita. Thank you so much for that insight. So Kavita, is there anything else you would like to add that will be of value to my listeners?
So we have talked a lot about parenting concepts out there till now, Jyoti. but one which I would still like to mention is about labeling. Huh. So what happens is that because nowadays there's an overdose of information.
True.
And one thing starts trending immediately, right?
Mm.
So similarly, when it comes to parenting and like developing bond and connecting with your children, it is advised that do not label your children.
Mm.
Now, if I may ask you, Jyoti, what do you understand by this term label? I mean, what do you understand by label?
Yeah, I think that was the first lesson I learned from my aunt. Okay. And she told me never compare, an apple to an orange. And you have to treat every child unique. And that was the first child I had. And that was the lesson I learned. And that's with me till now, Kavita. My son is 25 years now. And it remains with me. With the second child, I don't do the comparison. So it could be grades. It could be their projects, their success, their failures, no comparison, because I feel it's their walk of life and their story. And I'm with that journey. So that's what I feel. And that's how I have been with my children, Kavita.
Beautiful. And you are so right that there's no comparison, Jyoti, right? So label is a way of describing behavior or characteristic of a person in just one word. Like other than those labels, brand for clothes and other products that we have. So the if I could share the example of label with you, it would be like a child being creative, smart, shy, difficult, or bossy, or alcoholic, or irresponsible. Right. So these are labels.
Yeah.
So what needs to be understood is that there are different types of labels. And some labels are important and they cannot be done away with.
Mm.
But however, before using a label for any child or for even an adult, think through thoroughly. Because children especially tend to take these labels very, very seriously. And then they get fixated to these labels. And even start behaving to match up to that standard. So I've talked in my book about these and other concepts with the help of examples in a very simple, plain language to understand. So the book has my experiences and my learning with my daughters, right? And it also has sharing from other fathers out there, and especially also from grandparents. So if I have your permission, Jyoti, through this platform, I would like to add that please go and grab a copy of the book. It is available on Amazon.in and it will help you understand the science and art behind parenting.
Sure, Kavita. Definitely, that was a major lesson and takeaway for me on labeling. So ladies and gentlemen, all the links and resources which we have discussed in this episode will be made available in my show notes page on my podcast Stars of Learning, and also on my website prajvitaknowledge.com. That is P-R-A-J-V-I-T-A knowledge.com. You can check the description box for more details. Even Kavita had referred a book. I will put that link to your quick reference. So thank you so much, Kavita, for being on this show. I really enjoyed all the insight and tips on how to reinvent parenting journey. And what I learned in our conversation is that happy and conscious parenting is important. And there's no such thing as a perfect parenting. Parenting is a journey. Be a real one, you mentioned. I like that your three C's itself is very interesting. And your book on parenting. So friends, it's a must read to all parents. And also to keep the children, on the right path, listening to them, talking to them, and the three C's, to build that bond stronger, which you talked about, communicate, collaborate, and celebrate. So many insights. The gardening example was great, Kavita, and each stage is very fragile. And as a parent, we need to be really conscious about those stages. And your PTM grandmother story was also an interesting one. And once a parent is always a parent. Okay, guys, there is no escape from that. So that's what Kavita loudly saying that to us. So we need to follow that. And being a friendly parent, I really like that diversion, what you put in. And as a parent, it's a second chance for us, okay, not to the child, to be a better version of us. And that's what Kavita is calling out. And working on self, who needs to be aware, who need to unlearn, who need to practice, who need to implement, all of that goes to us as a parent. And that's when we can make a difference in the unlabeling was a major takeaway for me. And Kavita, my listeners will have a loads to take from this, and you have simplified the parenting journey. I'm sure if they follow all of these nuggets, they can make a beautiful parenting journey. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Jyoti, for so beautifully summarizing the entire discussion that we have had. So I loved your summarization. Thank you for doing that. And thank you once again for having me on your show. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, Kavita. It's been great having you on my show. Really appreciate your time. So friends, I hope you enjoyed this conversation with Kavita. And if you've got any learning or motivated hearing to Kavita, then please do tag Kavita and myself, and do share this podcast with your friends and post it on social handles about this amazing information you have learned, as this will help many others to engage, enlighten, and empower. By the way, friends, I'm always grateful to all my lovely listeners who tunes in to listen, subscribes, and leave a review, but if you have not done that yet, that would mean a world to me. So please head over to iTunes or YouTube or any other app and take just a minute to review, so that, I get to hear from you, and I really appreciate your support. Thanks for tuning in, friends. Bye for now. Take good care of yourself. Be safe and do something engaging, enlightening, and empowering. Thank you.